Series for us to get into, but she told me that she's also worship this morning, Lord, we pray that your Spirit will be our strength, your word will be our guide, and your love will be our comfort, and your promise will be our hope. Amen.
Amen.
Our whole series is on singing, and of course, the Book of Psalms is composed of those things. And we are reading today from Psalm 96. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord and bless his name. Share the news of his saving work every single day. Declare God's glory among the nations. Declare his wondrous works among all people. Because the Lord is great and so worthy of praise. He is awesome beyond all other gods, because all the gods of the nations are just idols. But it is the Lord who created heaven. Greatness and grandeur in front of him, strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Give to the Lord, all families of the nations, give to the Lord glory and power. Give to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring gifts, enter his courtyards. Bow down to the Lord in his holy splendor. Tremble before him, all the earth. Tell the nations the Lord rules. Yes, he set the world firmly in place. It won't be shaken. He will judge all people fairly. Let heaven celebrate. Let the earth rejoice. Let the sea and everything in it roar. Let the countryside and everything in it celebrate. Then all the trees of the forest, too, will shout out joyfully before the Lord, because he is coming. He is coming to establish justice on the earth. He will establish justice in the world rightly. He will establish justice among all people fairly. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Now we have the children come forward. Pastor Wendy has a little something for you.
You like to sing quietly?
Sometimes we're a little bit scared for others to hear our voice, and we sing quietly and sing out with joy. How about, have you ever heard any, you get up to sing and someone's yelling the song? Have you heard that? He said, sing modestly. Don't be yelling. Don't try and grab all the spotlight. And sing in time. If the song is nice and fast, sing it fast. If it's meant to be slow, sing it slow. And sing spiritually. What do you think that means? What do you think sing spiritually means? Sing from your heart. Sing to God. Singing is an important and fun way to love God. And we should sing when the Holy Spirit tells us to sing. And that's what we're going to do right now. Yeah, there's a song called Sing When the Spirit Says Sing. So we're going to get up and sing. You can face me or you can face them. And the words are up there. Up there. Up there. Take, eat, This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. On that same night, as the supper ended, he took the cup. Again, he gave thanks to God for the wine that was in the cup, and then he gave it to each of his disciples and said, "Drink this, each of you. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this and remember me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy living sacrifice in union with Christ, offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is dying. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on all of the people gathered here today and on these gifts of bread and fruit of the vine. By your power,
fill our voices with stories of your grace.
By your power,
strengthen our hands for the work of your mercy.
By your power,
transform us into the representatives of your love.
In great joy, anticipation, empowered by your Spirit, we await the return of Christ as we offer praise to you, Almighty God, in whom we live and move and have our very being. And now let us say together the words that Jesus taught us, praying, "Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
the power, and the glory forever. Amen." The children didn't go to Sunday school, did they? No, okay. Just seemed to be so quiet. We are going to share the bread and loaf. We're going to have two stations. There'll be real bread at both stations. There will also be gluten-free little peeling cups. So you will be given the bread, and then you dip it in the juice. And then you, if you want the gluten-free, there'll be children here offering you gluten-free elements. You partake and you put the leftover plastic into the waste paper box. Everybody here is welcomed at this table. We practice an open table. If you believe in Jesus, you participate with the Holy Spirit, you are welcome to come. The children are going to Sunday school today. They're going to leave now. We'll invite them back when it's time for donuts. And as they go, we're going to sing, lift every voice and sing. James Weldon Johnson wrote this hymn in 1900 for a choir of middle school kids, 500 of them. It was written to celebrate Abraham Lincoln's birthday. It has become known as the Black National Anthem. It is a hymn of hope, grounded in the belief that resilient faith can sustain us against oppression. Christ's resurrection, and to help us learn be resurrection people. People who know how to sing the new song, know how to find that hope. First Peter has been our guiding scripture. This letter is known for its profound Christology, the vision, the greater vision for the church, and they didn't even know how to call it church yet, but the vision, and ardent faith instructions for new Christians. Like those in the first Christian communities, we too have been learning to live a life of integrity and how to take risks to share the good news and do good works, even though it might cost us. We've been using music, all kinds of music, to celebrate the hope in Christ and the power of new beginnings. One of the songs that we were asked to explore when I asked you for suggestions, this one was suggestion, it's called The Hymn of Promise. It was written by Natalie Sleeth in 1919. Now, Natalie's husband was the Reverend Dr. Ronald Sleeth. He was a professor of homiletics, which means preaching. Natalie was an organist, and she eventually ended up writing 180 church and school songs. This particular hymn was written shortly after her husband was diagnosed with terminal cancer. He lived only a few more weeks, and he asked that this hymn be played at his memorial. Her song grew from the idea that in our end, in our death, our beginning is found. It's the beginning of new eternal life with God. So look at the images of hope in this song, The Hymn of Promise.
Seasons and weeks.
have left the Help Wanted posters up there on the wall for you to consider. But I want to tell you how the leaders of the Baltimore Washington Conference spent the week. I spent from Wednesday till Sunday this week, Saturday this week, felt like Sunday, thinking about the ladies, at the 239th session of the Baltimore Washington Conference, which was held in Baltimore. The conference was all about love, love for ourselves, love for others, love for God, love for the world. This conference gathered leaders, both clergy and lay, from each of the 603 churches in Maryland, Washington, D.C., and bits of Virginia. We gathered for conference business, like passing an $18.1 million budget, and voting on various resolutions which give our conference a new way forward and our next direction. We also gathered to celebrate the work of the local churches and extension ministries like CAMP. Now, some of our duties were really hard and heartbreaking. We voted to affirm the disaffiliation of 23 churches. That means that congregations who felt more aligned with the new denomination, the Global Methodist Church, or no denomination at all, took this step to leave the Baltimore Washington Conference. I tell you, just like tears were flowing. Someone just had to go to our rooms and take a break for a few minutes after that. It was a very sad time. But some of our tasks were exhilarating. We raised over $16,000 to assist victims of domestic abuse. We packed bags full of books and school supplies for all the students in 8 Baltimore schools. Buses full of men and women went out to 6 different locations to paint and repair and clean and restore those spaces. Awards were given to individuals and congregations. One young teen, I barely even know if she was a teen, she looked like 12. You can't tell on the videos. Her name was Sadie Claus, and she received an evangelism award for her work with Community United Methodist Church in Crofton. And listening to her journey reminded me of all the work that our teens have done in the past and the potential that is still in the children that are attending now. Another church earned a social justice award for figuring out how to help the immigrants that are arriving in Washington by the busload. How to help them just make it through that first day. They arrive early in the morning, like 6:30 in the morning, and they're hungry. So the first thing they receive is breakfast. But they also lack hygiene supplies, and they often arrive shoeless. I don't quite understand why their shoes are taken from them as they on this journey, of this entry process journey. So this church literally feeds, clothes, and then provides counselors to help the people go on from Washington. Washington is probably not their final destination. Most of them are heading to find relatives in other cities. Lay leaders, like me, and clergy persons from each church also gather to partake in inspiring Bible studies, intriguing sermons, and heartfelt worship. We are nurtured so that we can then nurture our congregations. I learned that our congregation is farther ahead of the curve in learning about the neighborhoods that surround us and learning to see all the people, stepping out to bring them the love of Christ. And that our work needs to continue with intention. I'm excited about partnering with Mount Zion for the Breakfast Club this morning, and I'm looking forward to joining Holy Family across the street for Vacation Bible School. And I wonder how else we can help our neighbors discover a life of faith that supports their marriages, encourages powerful parenting, or molds their business attitudes. What seeds, what bulbs, what caterpillars need to be nurtured? What songs will be sung into the silence? What songs are in the silence seeking words and melody? How can we help others know that God loves them and knows their very name?
Knows you intimately. Further instructions, but with a promise, come from these next few verses. But all of you leaders and followers alike are to be down to earth with each other. For God has had it with the proud, but takes delight in just plain people. So be content with who you are, and don't put on airs. God's strong hand is on you. He'll promote you at the right time. Live carefree before God. He is most careful with you.
In other translations, this last line says, give God all your cares, all your worries, all your anxieties. This is a passage of scripture that is often used when preachers need to preach on mental health. We can find God's strength in our weakness. We are chosen, we are forgiven, we are free, we are wanted children of God. We have a purpose in this life. God is good all the time, right?
All the time. God is good.
God's mercy never fails. Let's praise and sing about God's goodness.
Thank you.
created by humans, natural disasters, everywhere where there are people suffering, may we open the hearts and pray that God takes care of them. What prayers do you have for people that are in your family and friends? Debbie?
Additional prayers for Ann Simmons. She had additional medical complications and wasn't doing so well.
For Ann Simmons. For Steve Alexander, who's still in the hospital. Lee Argent, Bev Finn, Pat Stevenson, Vonda Bales, Jeannie's sister for ovarian cancer, and all of those needing God's healing touch. What prayers of joy do you have? Doris.
I just want to praise God and my doctors for giving me another trip around the sun.
Awesome. Happy birthday. At the conference, there were circles of love. So when we entered, instead of all the chairs being in rows for Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, they were in circles. And in the center of hundreds and hundreds of those circles were Adam's crosses. Adam, they had collected crosses maybe from our 175th, from another function that we had lent them crosses, and I brought 30 more down. And so all of us, the circles of grace, were centered around crosses made by Adam Schmidt. And we still have crosses left. We're not out of crosses yet, Adam. So we give those crosses to people when they're baptized, but also when they become members. But if you need one, if you need one for your home, we have still have crosses. I'd like to invite Noah Hall to come forward at this time.
Still is.
We know that. And as many of you know, our church has been giving out scholarships to our youth who are graduating out of high school. And it's always a joy to see the group that comes. Now, most of you can see what our children's group looks like now.
Start saying.
It'll be a while. I don't know how we got such a big gap, but anyway, what we're presenting Noah with today is just a little something from us, but I wanted to reflect a little while with going over his application for a scholarship, which is something that we make the kids do to let us know, you know, and let them express what this church has meant to them. Most of you are probably not aware of what our youth gets involved with, other than maybe the occasional mission trip, things like Tangier Island, where Noah went. But on his application, he listed the things that he has been involved with in our church, and it's just such a short list. He's been in youth group, mission trips, Pittsburgh, Tangier Island, Cornerstone Theater Productions, remember those? DUMC Summer Drama Camp, Sunday School, Festival, Strawberry and Peach, Live Nativity, Children's Ministry, DUMC Variety Show, Youth Choir, Children's Christmas Pageant, Acolyte, Scripture Reader, Confirmation, Outreach Project, Lunches for the Homeless, and Toiletry Kits, Vacation Bible School, participated and helped the UMC Holy Family, Crossroads Child Development Center alumni. Just a short list. So he had to answer some questions on his application, like, what are your plans for the future, his immediate future? He's going to the University of Maryland, Baltimore County, where he intends to major in mechanical engineering. Anything else you'd like to say about that?
No, I'm also playing the cross.
I imagine that. Now, our scholarships are often given in memory of the legacy of a church member, and what a is the legacy you wish to leave behind one day?
So the legacy for me, I kind of just want to be remembered as someone who had high character, highly respectable, and I just kind of wanted to be able to take my talents and kind of spread the word of God to everyone.
And we've got quite a list here of things that you've been involved with, and so how has Davidsonville really affected your life?
Well, I've been here since I was born, so it's basically been a key part of my entire life, growing up with so many people around me, providing me support, just lifting me up always, seeing everyone on Sundays, bringing a smile to my face, and just everything, teaching me to be a good young man, teaching me good morals. Everything has really just been the basis of who I am when I got into the real world.
So we are presenting Noah
with a $1,000 scholarship. This is being provided by a
combination of
United Methodist Men and the United Methodist Women. Thank you very much, Noah.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I am also blind.
people, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God. Please remain standing.
Resist the devil and stay strong in your faith. You know that all over the world, the Lord's followers are suffering just as you are. But God shows undeserved kindness to everyone. That's why he appointed Christ Jesus to choose you to share in his eternal glory. You will suffer for a while, but God will make you complete, steady, strong, and firm. God will be in control forever. Amen.
Other than the final salutation, these are the closing thoughts of Peter's letters to that first Christian community. So it's a reminder to stay awake in your faith. Be alert. Use your critical thinking to resist evil and injustice, or simply being swallowed up by our cultural ideas. Be centered in loving God and loving others. God showed undeserved kindness to everyone. So do that. Count on God to make you complete and strong and firm. Many weeks our benediction and response is similar to Peter's closing. I send you out with a blessing, and we sing on eagle's wings. This hymn is based on Isaiah 40, verses 28 and 31, and proclaims God's strength and will strengthen those that wait on him, trust in him, count on him for healing, inspiration, and renewal. It is one of the great truths that we base our lives on. Over the past 6 weeks, we have learned that we are resurrection people who sing a new song to the Lord. We are chosen, forgiven, and free to help others come to know, love, and serve God. Now may God, who sent Christ into the world to die for our sins, fill our hearts with a song that never dies. May the music of our faith make the whole world turn upon a divine rhythm. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Spirit.